feedback we're getting is incredible. Mm-hmm. Which is
after 4 years, a lot's changed since we've last put out a record.
Yeah,
we can't believe that, you know, certain fans have stuck with us and are willing to have waited and want to hear the new record.
It's quite hard to do when you get asked the question, what's it like to make an album? Because it's such a massive thing. It's quite hard to sort of pinpoint anything specifically apart from it was pretty hard.
We've got a pretty heavy work ethic. We know we have to get in there and push ourselves as players and songwriters. And it comes a point when the work starts paying off and you start to see it and it starts to flow.
3/4 of the way in, we knew that an album was emerging.
Thank God that point that comes where it all just starts to...
And the worst point is just before that, because you think there is no end in sight.
Just go from feelings of elation to despair and back. I don't want to sound dramatic, but, you know, we take it that seriously.
Yeah, that was a tough nut to crack.
Yeah, that was. There's always one song on a Doug's record that goes through about 8 different sort of versions, or you record it so many times. And we got help with that one from Tom Rowlands from the Chemical Brothers. He helped us arrange it, really. It was a big sprawling, it was just losing its way and getting too indulgent. Tom helped us sort of, obviously objectively being away from us and not having any agenda, he could obviously sit back and go, well, you know, you need a snip there, or he tried thinking of dropping down to the piano there, and he was just like, oh, right, it was great to have that input from someone else.
He showed us the way on that. But that, you know, that's one of my personal favourites, you know, because it almost didn't make the album. Yeah, I just think it's the most rewarding track, really.
10:03 on a fast train. A trick of light crossing my eyes. The sky would be. To the flame, I will turn back again. Oh, I'm coming home. I'm calling at your name. You're all I've ever known. Distant call. Calling out your name, Lord.
Greatest Denier, that's sort of lyrically we haven't really been there before, yeah. As Doves, and it's got a kind of menace.
It's got a menace sort of, musically and lyrically. There was loads of writing a few years ago in Rochdale and all around the north of England, you know, race riots basically, and it kind of became this like about this sort of person who's maybe realising that he's like sort of possibly racist, and he's finally realised that he's those views are redundant.
A word leapt out when we were, you know, just singing, yeah. And it was The Greatest Denier, and it was like that's interesting.
A really great title. Really, that's a really great. I hope we can run with this. Yeah.
Falls down to the future. No one knows in this empire. Cause I'm the greatest denier.
Touring again, and we've just finished a 6-day short UK tour, and it's been amazing. Great. It's been great. After you know, spending so long in the studio, it really is. This is, you know, why you do it. It's a breath of fresh air to come out and play, and just to test these new songs live.
So where's the stage? Do you know where this is? Lost.
It's been so intense, hasn't it, in the studio. It was just a massive relief just to get out there in front of people and
travel again.
Yeah, it's brilliant. It's what we're dying to do. Like, sort of second year into the album, it was like, oh, wouldn't it be great to just get out on the road?
Yeah, I mean, last summer, you know, another festival season had just passed us by, and we were like, but we weren't ready. At one point, we were like, you know, we better wrap this up and soon. But then we went, hang about, that's just not what we normally do. Instinct kicked in, and we're not going to damage this album by just, you know, just because the urge to get out and play was a bit overwhelming.
Thank you.
The very first verse was on a ripped on a reed organ that I had at my house. Mm-hmm. You know, that little, it's got like, it puts air through this organ. Yeah, it's like organ, a cheap eBay job, you know. And then we did try a rocky one where it was a different beat. Yeah. Then we went back to more of the sort of electronic side of it, and it seemed to have something. We obviously, we immediately knew, right, okay, this is sounding pretty electronic and
Kraftwerk-y,
you know,
it's our chance to try and get
some of those influences.
Yeah. What we always do is, like, if something's not quite working, let's say, on Jimmy's voice, then I will give Andy, well, you have the mic and you have a go at it.
Yeah, we just pass the mic.
And then
we just
pass the mic. Simple as that. There's no sort of, it's the song that it's the song that's got the ego, you know, not the individual. Yeah.
To get the
About.
We all say different things from it, don't we? I mean, you wrote the lyrics for that one.
It's kind of a road trip back to Preston, looking for something or someone. Don't ever really want to be too specific what you're going back to look for, because it's quite important for the listener to put themselves in that situation. So it's kind of really just trying to paint a picture and, you know, looking out the window and seeing things, you know, seeing cooling towers and just, you know, setting a scene, really.
Does that aspect, you're searching for something or a place maybe that you've lost or a person perhaps? But, you know, I mean, the chorus resonates. It just does. It takes notion of trust. I mean, I think that's like some days, you know, life is difficult, you know, and it's like stop and breathe and think, hang about, I've been here before. And if you just remember that and I got through it last time, I can get through it again.
Sound above the sound above my head, a distant sound of thunder booming out on the walls. Blackbirds, he flew ahead into the cooling towers. I packed my bags, thinking of one of those eyes. Thank you. So I'll wait.